in here. And this is like intent. Now if I come up here, we gotta score. Score, hey, score. And so, hey, oh, hey, oh, in there.
Gets me pumped every time.
AJ Hawk smoking a cigar is a very underrated portion of that.
I think that's just his role, right? Doesn't he just basically sits there when he's
is
on
that
the
what
show.
He does?
I think he just smokes cigars
he just takes a cigar
offers some reactions.
Love
this
it.
This is Purple Daily. We got to get Judd to smoke a cigar throughout. Just casually smoking a cigar, delivering his Kirk Cousins hate takes. This is Purple Daily. Phil Mackey, Judd Zolgad, executive producer Declan Goff, presented by TCL. Enjoy more of what you love with TCL TVs. And we got a four-question Friday on our hands that involves a little bit or maybe even a lot of
reckless speculation.
I will say the first item in four-question Friday, Declan did pose this question on Score North Twitter and Instagram and Facebook.
Yep.
And people lash out at us when we speculate or when we carry someone else's speculation to the audience. And I just want to know, like, if you are anti-reckless speculation, are you just no fun all the time? Are you just like, do you never have fun? Why do people get so worked up about, Danielle Hunter is chirping about his contract, and we'll get to it here in a second, but like, no, maybe here's a trade offer with the Cowboys. I wonder if Vikings would entertain this. What a shame on you. Shame on you for speculating that they might trade. Oh, we're just having fun. Bill Barnwell's just having fun.
That's what I don't get is if we make it up, then I get being mad at us,
yes.
Maybe.
And we but
when
that
it's,
too.
But when it's Bill yeah. Barnwell, who works for ESPN, and Declan just parrots it, which is, you know, fair game, right? It's yeah. a fun little thing. And people are like, Declan, I hope you die tonight. Well, you're like, no, that's not, no, I was just... I'm just pointing out what Bill Barnwell said.
And I will haunt you from your blogging graves when I am passed on to the next eons. And also, like, people love to say, too, like, oh, you, I see you're posting that graphic. We did that 4 days ago. It's like, oh, so you have copyright graphic laws on every other person that says something? Like, I have to check with you on that? Like, it's just, it's happy Friday. Yeah. It's a great start.
Now that we have overreacted to three trolls on the internet, it's time for Four Question Friday here, presented by our friends also at Wamatech. So if you're watching or listening on a broken down device, a phone, tablet, laptop, time to break down and get a new one. You don't have to break the bank, though. That's where Wamatech, a local company, comes in. They source pre-owned devices directly and pass the savings on to you. They'll even buy your old device for cash. It's a good deal. Buy, sell, trade in, whatever you need, Wamatech.com, WAMATEK.com. All right, boys, question number one.
You like that?
Bill Barnwell did a trades-only mock draft on ESPN.com. And he has the Vikings involved in two different things here, okay? We'll start with the first one. I'm going to start you off easy here, okay?
Okay.
The Vikings trading with the Steelers. So they would move down from 14 to 24.
Mm-hmm.
And also, so there'd be the first-round pick swap. And for doing that, the Vikings would get the Steelers' first-round pick next year, and they would give the Steelers a fourth-round pick next year. So they would swap first and fourth next year for the Steelers to move up 10 spots this year. Would you do it?
Oh, personally, I would not do it. Do I think the Vikings would? Yes. This is the exact type of trade I expect. Now, I think that their main goal is going to be to get back into the second round this year. So that will be, I think, the priority. But that trade is far from absurd. And that's a Rick type of trade, man. You move back, especially, look, if they truly have decided Quiddy Pay would be a good pick, You Phil, just hit on the sweet spot of where Quiddy Pay probably should go without us being like, oh my God, what are you doing, right? So I personally would stay at 14, and if I could, I would take the best available offensive tackle. But that strikes me as the type of trade the Vikings would make.
Sometimes I think Rick Spielman gets more obsessed with winning the trades in the draft than like getting the best impact player that can help your team win. That said, if it's getting you're moving back 10 spots, you're still going to get a pass rusher if you want one, or you know, Barmore might still be there at 24, and you get a first-round pick next year, I would do this. Here's the main one, though. Bill Barnwell has the Cowboys at 10, trading. They would trade the 10th pick to Minnesota and a second round pick and a fourth round pick. So Vikings get the, they move up to 10. They get a second round pick and they get a fourth round pick, another one. And they would give Dallas the 14th pick, so there'd be a pick swap in the first round. And Danielle Hunter. So Hunter coming off the neck surgery, he wants to get paid. I mean, for the Vikings to do this, I would think that they'd be moving up to get, like, it would be like Penei Sewell falls to 10. I don't know. It would be hard to even pinpoint who they would trade up for if it wasn't Penei Sewell. But would you guys consider Danielle Hunter in a trade to move up in the first round and get an extra second round pick for this year?
Dex, go ahead.
Yeah, if one of those guys, if Sewell is there, I'm considering it. If Slater's there, I'm considering it. But in Barnwell's suggestion here, too, he is literally saying there's a scenario in which the first nine players are off the board on offense. So that's all the five quarterbacks, Sewell, Pitts, Chase, and then one of the two Alabama wide receivers, he says in his write-up. If Sewell is gone, and I guess maybe Slater's there, that's the only reason I'd move up to 10. Because I don't know if from 10 to 14 if Slater's going to fall to 14. So if Slater's available, I can consider it. But unless like one of the, like Sewell is there, or heaven forbid, my guy Kyle Pitts is, I can't do that trade. I don't think I can. I don't think I can.
I don't think I can do that trade based on unless I know that I am that Hunter's neck is not coming back as expected, and the Cowboys don't know that or they can't find that out. I can't do that trade because here's my problem. If I do that trade, I have to get a guy that can rush. Like I've now traded my left end, who's really good when healthy. I don't have a right end. Zim might kill me if I make this trade. And so, yeah, I don't see from a standpoint of a team that has really spent the last, 3 months or so doing nothing but trying to improve their defense. I can't now trade Hunter and take an offensive tackle. Personally, I think they do need one. And then who are my rush ends? I've got zero.
Yeah, so this is a nuke button trade. If you make this trade, you're pushing the nuke button on your 2021 season in terms of like if you want to win a Super Bowl, you need Danielle Hunter healthy and rushing the passer and wreaking havoc, like straight up. You're also hitting the nuke button on Mike Zimmer as the head coach, right? Cuz now you're actively sabotaging. You'd also just be sabotaging all the things that you added in the offseason. Like, why would you add all these things in the offseason and then trade Danielle Hunter?
Exactly.
So it's a pretty ridiculous notion, although I have to commend Bill Barnwell for being super creative and creating 32 trades for a mock draft here.
Oh, bravo.
Just the level of recklessness here is
reckless speculation.
Off the charts. All right, question number two here on a four-question Friday. Tom Brady is pissed about the NFL relaxing jersey numbers. So he's been all over his social media. Someone screenshotted one of his posts, and I'll explain here in a second, but he even retweeted it sometime this morning or yesterday. I'd like to speak to the manager, please. Just like old guy mad. Yeah. So he's saying with the NFL relaxing jersey numbers, so like if you're a defensive end, you won't just have to wear a number in the 90s. You could wear a single-digit number. I haven't looked at the ranges, but he's saying it's going to be nearly impossible offensively to figure out who to block because you're so used to, as a quarterback, you get up there and you're like, okay, there's the guys wearing the 90s. There's the guys wearing the 20s and the 30s. There's the guys wearing the 50s. Now it's like you could have a linebacker wearing number 6 and an edge rusher wearing number 5, and you won't be able to tell right away based on numbers what position a guy plays, right? It's going to take some, you'll have to like memorize all of their numbers instead of just a range of numbers, which might sound like a really menial thing, but I buy into it. I mean, if you're that masterful at the line of scrimmage and you're reliant on a range of numbers to know what position the guy plays and you're trying to make snap judgments quickly, I can see why Brady is pissed about this, and it's hilarious.
It is hilarious. So I get why he's pissed. I give you my assurance. The people that changed this rule gave that zero thought. Like, they didn't consult with quarterbacks. They don't care. I just think it's great that because here's the thing. Brady's so damn good that like you can't take a thing he says, in my opinion, and dismiss it as like, oh, that's just old man talking, right? Like he's probably got a very good point. The people that changed the rule clearly did not give this an iota of thought. But he's probably justified. He probably is. And if he's pissed, imagine like how a quarterback who had just gotten used to who's wearing what or something like that coming out of college feels. So yeah, I gotta say, one is it is hilarious he's so mad, but it's probably justified.
Now, to your point, a lot, you know, one of the big reasons why teams don't retire more numbers is because you're going to run out of numbers, right? If you can't retire like six wide receiver numbers because your current wide receivers won't have enough numbers to wear. So this might open the door to a Randy Moss jersey retirement. Finally, get that number 84 up in the rafters at US Bank Stadium. Boys, question number three presented by our friends at PXG, looking to increase the decrease the strokes on your golf card. That's where PXG's Gen 4 golf clubs come in. Drivers, fairways, hybrids, irons, best performing clubs the PXG has ever made. And you can find them at PXG Minneapolis in Southdale Center, along with great apparel. In fact, I got a box yesterday from our friends at PXG with some apparel. I was going to open it on the show, but it's literally like reinforced with eight layers of tape, and so I have to find a scissors.
Whoa, somewhere. You got like shirts and stuff?
I don't know. There's PXG swag in a box.
Dex, has your showing up yet?
Not yet. Well, okay. You know, I do have a FedEx. I got a random FedEx notification 3 days ago, and I don't know what it's for. Hmm. So maybe it is. Who knows? Maybe.
It's not ticking, right?
Or it's anthrax.
Not yet.
Tick, tick, tick. That might be a problem.
PXG Minneapolis in Southdale Center. Find out more at pxg.com/Minneapolis. Okay, question number three.
You like that?
So speaking of NFL rule changes, all right, among the other rule changes, I'll give you guys a few of them here. I want to know if you strongly agree or disagree with any of these. So I'll just read through these real quick and you guys chime in. So video replay official now given more leeway to chime in. So for a long time, you know, we've had these replay officials up in the booth and they can chime in if they're summoned, right?
Right.
And now replay officials can, for instance, advise referees in the moment if they see specific objective aspects of a play that are clear and obvious. So like if a ball bounces off the ground and it's being ruled a completed catch. Like, you don't have to have that be challenged. An official can just jump in and make a call.
Yep.
So instead of having to waste time with a challenge flag being thrown, they'll just be able to say, oh, I saw the replay. Let's reverse that call. Tweaking the onside kick rule to remove two players from the setup zone. So instead of having 11 players crowded in, the team receiving is going to take two players out. This was a middle ground between keeping the current setup and adding the 4th and 15 which would be super fun.
Just go to that. It makes too much sense. The 4th and 15 thing, the onside kick. Look, they are doing everything they possibly can to take the kickoff and the onside kick and destroy it. And I almost get that. Okay, concussion concerns. The 4th and 15. It's perfect. It's the middle ground. It's where they should end up. I mean, do you know how much fun that could be? And plus, guess what? The teams with good quarterbacks and pass protection and receivers benefit from it. I mean, I don't see an unintended consequence or downside to the 4th and 15. And it feels like the onside, like they're trying to keep kickoff elements around, Phil, and it's just old and it's not working. The 4th and 15, go to it. The sooner you go to it, the better.
Yeah, so several teams have proposed this alternative where you'd run a single play from your own 25-yard line instead of an onside kick, and it's a 4th and 15, straight up. Owners have rejected that proposal multiple times, including one this spring by the Philadelphia Eagles. Instead, they adopted this suggestion. Why are they rejecting this?
I don't know. Because they're old and stuck in their ways? I mean, seriously.
Or do they want something collectively? Is it like, oh, if we're going to give you some? No, it's not. You're just making the game better. You're making it more entertaining. It's like when the NBA smartened up at some point and said, you know, long ago, if you call a timeout, you can advance the ball past half court.
Right.
Well, that's not fair. I don't care if it's fair. It's fun. It makes the games more fun.
Right, exactly. How do you end baseball games that go into extras? Oh, I don't know. Maybe put a guy on second and old people
can do that.
And old people are still bitching, but guess what? I don't care. It's fun and it gets the game done. I never want to sit through a 17-inning game again in my life, okay?
Yeah, yeah, get with the times, football. Go ahead.
I was going to say on the first thing with the replay official now, getting more power on the surface, it sounds good, but I am a big fan now of unintended consequences in officiating that come up. I guarantee you there are things they didn't think of that are going to become a problem here. There always are.
That brings us to the third one on my list, which is addressing offensive holding, which is what we all really wanted here. Offensive holding calls plummeted by more than 40% last year to their lowest per-game total since 1972, which I love. Let these guys play a little bit. I'm fine with it. What will happen is Senior Vice President of Training and Development, Walt Anderson, will create a long video to teach officials, coaches, and players what should and shouldn't be called this season. So it sounds like they're going to put an emphasis on offensive holding, which sounds great for Dakota Dozier, by the way. That's going to help him quite a bit.
What? Okay, I have several questions. I'll start with this one. I thought the de-emphasis on holding was on purpose. Like, I thought the league said, we've watched a bunch of our own games, and they're really boring. How can we make it unboring? There's holding on every play. Don't call it, right? So are we now? So we're now saying, hold on a second. You didn't have enough holding flags? I mean, 2 years ago, and Royce brought this up at the time, and he's exactly right. The problem is, every big play, you would look back at the line of scrimmage and be like, where's the flag, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we want to go back to that?
No. Let them play,
but,
man.
But what you just read indicates to me that they do.
Mm-hmm.
Like, so we're going to have Walt Anderson. Do you know how much that man loved to throw flags?
Dude.
Like, Walt Anderson?
It should be, if it's not, I mean, this is subjective, but like, if it's obviously impeding a defender's ability to wreck a play, let's call it, okay? If these guys are hand fighting a little bit and someone catches a jersey, like, I don't need every. It's like the people that want more traveling called in the NBA. Why don't they call traveling? Are you serious?
Right.
That's what you want? Boy, that NBA game would have been more enjoyable with six more traveling calls. It would have really been fun.
And you want. So you're telling me flat out that you want Russell Wilson, Rodgers, go down the list of top quarterbacks.
Pominville?
You're telling me you want their greatest plays to be undone by holding calls, because that's what we're going to be back to. Here's a huge play, and there's a flag.
I'm here for the Walt Anderson show, baby. What great form on that flag throw. What a clutch penalty call with 2 minutes left in that game.
Honestly, I saw that. That drove me crazy.
You like that?
Walt Anderson. All right, question number four for you guys. We'll start with Dex here. Who is your ride or die favorite mock drafter?
Ooh.
You only get one. You get one mock drafter to follow, and only one for the rest of your life. Who are you choosing?
I think he counts. I know he's more of like a draft analyst. He's not. I don't know if he's a huge mock drafter, but I do love me some Daniel Jeremiah.
I think he's a mocker, right?
He's a mocker. I know he's been on the show before too. There's a little bit of bias there, but I think he does a phenomenal job. He knows inside and out. Like, don't be wrong. The Todd Father and Kuiper are great. Awesome. They're aggregated. But, like, Daniel Jeremiah is plugged in. I seriously, we've talked about it before. Draft season never sleeps. It's a 365-day-a-year thing. It's hilarious to me. And kudos to them who make a living out of doing this. But I will say Daniel Jeremiah. He's definitely my ride or die.
Judd?
It's cliched, but I have to. Mel Kiper Jr. I mean, the man's been doing this since the 80s. He was, you know, mailing out packets of mock drafts in, you know, sticking a stamp on them at one time.
And Todd, he has had his replacement sitting next to him for 15 years at ESPN, and he's staved him off for 15 years.
And Todd's getting old now, but I mean, like, this year he's like, I'll do trade. He's the guy that his bosses, I guarantee you, every year say, okay, Mel is going to see what we're doing now, and he's going to be out, right? He's going to retire. He's going to step down. It'll be Todd, it's your show. It's your show now, because you know what? Once we tell Mel that he has to do trades, he'll be out. And Mel's like, oh, no, I'll stick around. I'll do the trades. I mean, Mel's not going to quit. Mel's going to die before he quits. And I love that about Mel.
I got to be honest. So my favorite mocker of all time is not really eligible to mock the last couple of years because he's running a franchise. He's so great at mocking, he's running a franchise. Mike Mayock. I always loved me the Mike Mayock mock. And the way that he would sit there for 7 hours on draft day and just break everyone down. And he was very wrong on a lot of high profile guys. But I love his unique football cadence, just everything about Mike Mayock. I hope he gets fired soon so that we can get him back on NFL Network and NFL.com with the Mike Mayock mock.
So the second time in 2010, when Favre came back in Mankato, he didn't come to Mankato, but the news broke, Phil. I think you and Tom were covering it that day at the time as well. Mayock, as I recall, Mayock was in town doing Viking stand-ups and stuff for the network. And so the Favre thing breaks, and they're like, you know, Mike, you got to get on this, blah, blah, blah. So they had me on as a guest to talk about what I had heard. And honest to God, I think Mayock wanted to kill me because the speculation, you talk about a guy that didn't like reckless speculation. And so I was talking about, you know, what Favre might or might, and ordinarily a reporter would be like, oh, this is great. I'm getting some insight, right? We'd like get done and he'd like shake his head and he like that this is such harm. And he was just hated the whole thing.
Only deals in reality is not in hypotheticals.
Well, in Mike's mind, Mike's mock drafts were reality to him. Like they might've been way off, but he was like, this is me. I'm football guy. And I think standing by writer guy who he knew couldn't block a spider really bothered him.
Football. Block a spider.
Oh, man. All right. That is 4 Question Friday here on Purple Daily with Mackie and Judd, executive producer Declan Goff. 4 questions. 4 questions.
4 questions. And we played through the last question.
Repeat. 4 questions.
Fourth quarter. All right. That's a wrap on this episode. Thanks. Oh, by the way, next week, it's draft week, and we are all in. I'm getting my second Pfizer shot on Wednesday next week, and probably
I'm ready to go.
Everybody I see just feels like garbage the next day, so it'll be my Michael Jordan flu game next Thursday.
I got the whole thing. I'll carry the whole thing. I'll host the entire thing.
All right, we'll see you guys later.